regarding about the prospect of Somali Christians, black and minority ethnic young people, which reflects the community's feelings and sentiments. So that's the aim of the event. My name is Sahara Kosar. I'm one of the volunteers of this event. I'm also a member of the board of Somali Bristol Somali Resource Center. My big job is a social worker employed by Bristol City Council, so I volunteer to be part of this event. I know, I can imagine how busy you are, all of you, so thank you very much for coming this and dedicating your invaluable time to this event. So I would welcome first Jalahi from Bristol Somali Resource Center, the manager, to give us the health and safety of this place in terms of the... So I would welcome to Hussein Mahmoud. Come up, Hussein. This is Hussein Mahmoud, one of the leaders of these events. And also, I would like to welcome also Abdi Mohammed. Yeah, I would also like to welcome Abdulazad. Hussein will first tell us how this has started and what actually how this has started. And Abdi will give us some methodology about some of the reports that have been done. And Abdulazad will give us the overview of the and out, you know, actually the content of the report and the, of this event.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. Somali community were very, very unprepared. The magnanimity and the intensity of the media and the everything, because of a number of things, really. We have a background of, for example, people not talking about sex at all. Sex is something that should be undercover, behind closed doors, and you don't talk in public. So when everything came out, when a court case came out, it put everything outside, and the people were in denial to start with, but eventually it sank in that we had problems. When Operation Brooks finished, then the follow-up, another operation with the same trials came up, and only then the people realized, we have a problem. We have a real problem. How can we address it? And really, we didn't know how to address it. And if I just give you a little thing about the background, myself, really, how shocking it was when I came into this country nearly 30 years ago. I went to a college in Sheffield, and we were doing some media program. And I remember I just came into a class where some students were just making a program of safe sex. And all of a sudden, a girl, young girl, just put a microphone out to my face and said, "What do you think about safe sex?" Came into here, and I didn't know what she was talking about, because for me, sex was something that you cannot say in public. So surely she wasn't talking about sex, I think. And I said, "What do you mean, safe sex?" And she said to me, "Don't you know the word?" And then I was still bewildered. You see, because I wasn't expecting, even if it's the right word, a girl, you know, saying to me, you know, someone just putting microphone in the public, and also happened to be a girl saying it, I was quite confounded. And then eventually she said, "Don't you even know that?" And I said, "If you say that one more time, I'll slap you in the face. Don't you ask me that." And I just spoke that little class. And this is the background we all came from. So So when this happened, a few years back, then it was shocking. It was shocking it happened. It was also shocking it happened from Afghanistan. So it was shocking. And because we didn't have the education and the preparation, we didn't know how to deal with it. And we had everybody just going around, this is the police doing this, it's not right. This is the media doing it, it's not right. This is the council, but all these things. But that went taking us nowhere. So in the end, we have to come together and say, well, we have to look at it, you see, and perhaps say properly in public. It was difficult for us. There were some ladies, thank you very much, some of them are here today, who started it. They were the ladies who say, we have a problem. The fathers were saying, no, we don't have a problem. And even if we have a problem, those young people, young men who did it, you know, has to go to jail and that's it. And they thought it was just a finishing that. They didn't think, well, maybe some other ones would just come after that and some other ones. And you see, the ladies were more cleverer and more practical, saying, we have a problem, we have to work out. I'm glad that it came to this point and that you are here today. It looks like we're going to hand over to you because you're service providers and you are going to be the people who are going to be mending whatever the problems are. I think that's how we started really. That's all I can say today.
Thank you. So welcome Abdi, who will give us some overview about the methodology of the consultation that we have. We have carried out in the Somali community and some of the organizations as well.
Thank you, Sarah. Then we started with about the number. Are we significant? Are we really, it is worthy to talk about this. So as you know, Somalis are 10,000, roughly. They may be less, they may be more. And it's due to the maybe the people going coming up and down, the number of bar. And there is also a significant number of children in the local schools. 4 years ago, one of my teachers told me, if the number is going like this, you really need to do something up. Because if the number is increasing every month, every year, then it will be easier to identify your problems. So probably the reason why Somalis probably was in the media, maybe the number was really very, very high. I don't want to go into detail, then we can go to the next slide. So the reason why we undertake this is only two objectives. One, to find out about the challenges, how the community see the challenges, and what are the possible solutions from them. I will share with you later how they feel. Maybe some of those things that they say, you may say, well, you don't agree with them, but that's in fact what they feel. And the second, community to work with the local organizations. Because when the operation group came in, we are all of us in panic. As Hussein said, we don't know where to engage, where to go, how to solve the problems. So now we have to start. To engage with the locals. Thanks for catch up. They are here today.
Catch two.
Helen, thank you. So I didn't know what they do, but today I know what they do. So the benefits that we get today is like that. I heard the name Catch 22, but I was not really aware what they do because I was busy myself. Everybody's busy. So thank you very much. And methodology that we follow was very, very simple. We met over 130 Somali. And this comprises young kids, both male and female, parents, elders. And we asked them very informal, I mean, very structured. We asked them about the theme of the problem that we want to ask. And they were really very happy and joyful. And that's how we, and the soccer group is facilitated by male and female. When we contacted the kids, their parents were present, or the consent was received from the parents. And these are the main thing we really establish the final solution. And now I will hand over to you, Dr. Isabu, who will give us the finding of the report. And thank you very much.
So one of the crucial things I think for us was, as highlighted by Hussein, I think in his opening remarks, our culture and our households vary significantly to what young person or young people do in the streets. So the street life culture, as we know today, in my days we used to call it like hip hop or trendy, you know, whatever is trendy there and there, it's different to what is practiced in young people's homes. And quite often, families, if you like, or parents in particular, and I'm one, we're more concerned about getting young people to learn about the culture. So my culture, you know, our religion, our culture. These were significantly important in the households, in parents. When you speak to parents, this is really important. But it's not vice versa. So what we've learned is parents aren't looking to learn about what's happening in the street life, you know, like what's happening in the street life culture, if you like, or what's apart from obviously when young people come down and say, I want to buy nice trainers or whatever it is that they want. But there's a gap between the family life and the street life culture. It's really important that we recognise what you see as a parent is not what the children and young people are seeing. What they see is a different view to what your view is. If you can see what's happening around you, they can certainly see what's going on. And quite often, and I'll come on to it in a minute, what are the things we found are drug dealers themselves are actively recruiting young people. And this is absolutely cool. And I'll come on to some of the stats we looked at, which I should mention actually, the police kindly supported us in the stats we used to support some of the conversations. Sex and relationship again, the root causes were identified and possible solutions following Operation Brook. Three main things sort of came up under this, and I've put this into a donut chart, if you like. So you've got the peer pressure, 25%, I think, of the causes were identified as peer pressure. 22% lack of parental skills, and again, that's about communicating with young people, and lack of sex education. And I remember when first sex education was sort of come online in terms of schools. I don't know whether you all remember, you know, there was a big hey, you know, like a lot of Somali parents did not necessarily support that at all, but it's certainly something I think we need to revisit. And it's not about just refusing, it's about saying, how can we make it relevant? And I think that's a crucial thing. How can we make it culturally? You know, I think Hussein talked about how older generation cannot bring ourselves to talk about sex and relationship. But I think it's certainly something which we need to grasp fairly quickly as a community and make sure we communicate or we find a way of communicating that with our young people. I think it's important that we all recognise that there are, you know, it's not all doom and gloom. Because the other thing I should mention is the police data provided to us doesn't talk about numbers. So we're not clear whether four or five people are causing all these prolific issues here, or there's 1,000, 2,000 children. So we're not saying all our children are really involved in this issue. But one thing that certainly the data supports is that active drug dealers who are recruiting young people, in particular when they're most vulnerable, and we're talking about at that age. The trigger age for us, like I said early on, is 16, 17, 18. So if we're going away with anything today, the vulnerable children from 16 onwards, or, you know, I guess you're right, 16 onwards, it's a big issue. And during that time, also, what's important to bear in mind is that they're taking their GCSEs. And if they don't really perform really well their GCSEs or their education or what have you, they're not getting support in achieving, well, not necessarily getting support, I'm sure you've given them as much support as possible, it becomes a dilemma. It becomes, you know, it's a serious issue. Anyway, I'm running out of time. I'm being told again and again. So I'll just finish off by saying we found there's definitely a correlation between lack of recreational activities for young people, in particular men, leads to boredom, which leads to ASB, lower level ASB, which then becomes more serious times and ultimately into a serious incidents like we've heard. I should also stress in terms of us as parents, we need to take more ownership and get more involved, in particular where it matters. So it's not about leaving it to the police or leaving it to agencies to deal with this. It's about us actually organizing ourselves, because there's definitely a gap, information gap, between us as parents and Somali community members, and certainly from these, there are poor partnerships that happen, talk about all these issues, but yet not many people sort of participate or go to these sort of partnership arrangement meetings, if you like. The issue is presented here in this report. It's not a BME or Somali problem. I think it's really important we say that. It isn't. It's a, we're talking about the future of this city's kids. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about our young, our future generation. We want them to be contributing to our development positively, not necessarily in a very negative way.
Yeah, this was actually, this event, as it was said earlier, Operation Brooks was a wake-up call, I mean, from the community. This project is not a branch of Operation Group, but it's the community, as the result of the Operation Group, the community came together and took some responsibility of what we can do about it. So although it has been identified some possible causes of the problems and possible solutions, it's no way to justify whatever problem is identified that doesn't justify of what has happened. And the what has been to the victims. And my condolence on behalf of my team and all of you goes to the young girls and their families who are affected by and everyone who was affected and the community and everyone who was affected by Operation Brook. These issues which have been identified in terms of sex-related crimes, drugs, especially sex-related crimes against young women or girls and young or women are a global problem. But we have control over our environment, our children, our families. So we should all take responsibility, a collective responsibility, to address this, to work together and find out possible solutions to address this. So now I would like to welcome Adara Omar Sabriye, who is a member of the Somali Elders, who will speak on behalf of the Somali Elders. I'm aware of the Somali culture. Elders are the focal point of the community of the consultation. I'm not including the member of the elders or the elders. That's not right. So I'd like to welcome Adara Sabriye.
All I want to say is, I came to this country myself, I think 2003. And when I came to Stable Road and other areas, of course, here, as well as factory, these are all places. And sometimes no area, or you cannot just enjoy what you have to stay. That's all. It was difficult. Now, our arrival was both advantage and disadvantage. Advantage simply because we have changed. Acceptable is when you witness yourself. Now, where is this problem a child? If a child leaves primary and goes to secondary school for year 7, and then I spend myself more time on education in this country. From there, as you understand, the people are, some students are academic, some are visual or practical. We have different people, different individuals. So what happens is, so in early stage, the schools will start, if they have a problem with a child, and then they exclude. That exclusion leave us in very, very bad image. Because once you expel the child, the third is a dealer, they go direct to the streets. There, the child meets the whole problem. Drugs, gun culture, everything is there on the streets. So I used to ask people there who work with me, my colleagues, please do not expel, do not, just don't give them. You try to isolate them here in the room or keep this child until it grows up. That didn't happen. And then it led to what we are now discussing here, the problems of Yakubi. So I was not really very nice for giving this talking from here, but what I can tell you is, you guys who are in front of us and coming from different departments, we need your help at this stage. We need your assistance. We want to see that you are still helping our people. And we will have ours. I think, and everybody witnessed it, that the Somali community here in Bristol is far different from the one in 2000. We have increased in number, and the more you increase in number, the more your activities increase, whether positive or negative. I am proud of my children. When I say my children, I'm talking about also my children and other even all children. You see? Because without children, you cannot enjoy your life. You know. But you will be upset. When they go on the road, in the wrong direction, you will be very, very upset. I hope that my friends, my friend Mr. Hussein, who of course tried his best to bring all this together, I thanked him as well. He's really encouraging our community to understand more how to live with other people who helped you from zero, empty set. How you can go with it. You should be conducted. You should be careful of everything. You should be benefiting from the people and not hurting them. No. If you hurt, you are the weakest link. You have to understand that.
I wanted to talk about, very quickly, as you all know, we're currently consulting on the targeted commissioning of targeted services. And for me, I don't even think I need that, actually, because this one is quite close to my heart. So what I really loved about what I was hearing, the community is talking about how we can work together, how the agencies can work with our communities. They're not asking for any additional resources. You're not saying we want money. You're not saying we want to set up yet another organization to do something. We're talking about genuine collaboration and partnership across the piece. And that is mine and the mayor's expectation actually going forward. So I want to ensure that you all take the opportunity to input into the youth consultation process, make your views known. This report is extremely important and needs to feed into that. And I will expect any submissions coming forward from agencies, because one of the things that we are keen on is that partnership and collaboration. The mayor has set up the city office for a reason. Bristol City Council cannot do everything on its own anymore. We all have dwindling resources, so the only way that we're going to tackle some of the really wicked issues of this city is whether to bring all of our resources together. So that means agencies, whether you're mainstream or smaller grassroots organisations, coming together to try and address many of the issues that we've heard today. And I don't mean lip service, okay? It's about true collaboration and partnership. I've seen it happen, I've been around a long time, so I know it can happen. So I want to see over the next few months, even before we get to the process where people are going to be bidding, any contracts or any commissioning process, whatever comes out of the consultation, I actually want to see, and I'm going to name names, I want to see creative youth network, I want to see learning partnership with But there are other organisations. There's Phoenix Social Enterprise that I discovered is doing amazing work that are taking our young people out into Europe and giving them opportunities and work experience opportunities in Europe. We've got Black Southwest Network and a whole range of other agencies that if you need advice and support and help, talk to the organisations that exist. We've been around for a long time.
And I think that Bristol is a lovely city with a lot of opportunities and for parents and children to understand each other well, and also for like communication between them and between the community, and not to put each other down as well, to see every child, as a parent, see every other child as their own and not to think of their children as, you know, on a pedestal and others are lower. And I would think that, I think there just needs to be unity between all, and there needs to be an understanding between parents and kids. Especially as a Somali, there needs to be understanding of the culture we're in. Right now, I'm in a British Somali culture, and it's not going to be the same as my parents' culture. And parents need to educate themselves. As long as, and as he said, as parents want to enforce the Somali culture upon us, but we need to enforce the British culture upon us. That's where we live, you know.
One way that we can exceed is to work together. And that working together that I'm repeating over and over again is to make sure that the young people are the heart of the process of everything that we're doing.
I will be in a mission to educate, empower, motivate, and transform young people, one young person at a time, one school at a time, one community at a time. And you know why? I've been very fortunate. I studied master at uni. I studied a degree, had first class. I did a course. I studied also at Oxford University. I've done all the qualification part. But truly, what I wish I was taught at school wasn't that. It wasn't calculus, it wasn't algebra. What I wish I was taught at school was, if I fail, how should I fail forward? What I wish I was taught at school was, when I feel stressed, how to deal with my emotions. What I wish I was taught at school was, how the hell should I manage my time? How can I be more productive? How can I be more organized? How can I nail my goals? How can I set my goals? How can I deal with stress? And stress is not a joke. Yes, sex education is important, but what's more important is how to deal with my emotions, with my well-being. And with our budget, what's going on around the world, we need to dedicate every person to know how to look after themselves first, one person at a time. It's such a sad story. While I was at uni, one of my fellow classmates committed suicide at Leicester University, when I studied in 2010. Very unfortunate. It was extremely overwhelming. Because what schools are teaching us, if you fail an exam, you are a failure. But truly is, I have studied maths degree, but never used it a day, even though I had a first. It doesn't necessarily mean there are other doors. I've been very fortunate enough to work with the United Nations, I've coached, I've worked in Southeast Asia, and around the world a bit. But never used my degree, but if someone told me it's okay to fail. I think today, really, my mission in life is make a difference in young people's life. And for me, that genuinely starts by their education and exposing them to so many opportunities. Being aware of what's going on here. With all due respect to all service providers, my young people will tell you, we did some research asking them, what service have you used? And these are born here. What are you aware of? And we were told clearly, none of the services that which are supposed to be the leading are providing services for them. Which for me was shocking. So where is the problem? Is the problem either they're not aware they exist, or is the service not changing enough? So where's the question here? So I think for everybody here, our duty is to kind of do what I call extend hand and ask, can we have a conversation of possibilities and say, what could be possible?
You need a positive mindset to literally go anywhere in life. No matter where it is, you could do anything you want in your life. And I always had that. I was like, I'm going to graduate from uni, I'm going to do my master's, get a good graduate job, and that's it. That's where my life ends. But then through coaching, as I realised, there's much more to that. There's something called networking, where you can meet millions of different people, which I, honestly speaking, have never come across. I've never seen it. I was like, okay, I'm just going to graduate, get a good job, hopefully a good job. After I graduate from my, get a first class degree, possibly, but graduate and get a good job, that's all I thought to life. That's all I saw to life. But then I realised there's more. There's something called you can get experiences from other people, you can learn from other people. And I realized with coach, yeah, and her aiding me that I could be the best I could possibly be.
One of the things I've learned in Code Class is do a vision board, because I used to say to myself, oh, I'm going to do that, I'm going to try to achieve that goal, but I would never actually do it. But having a vision board really helps, because if you put it where you see it every day, it motivates you to actually get there and actually do it.
If I fail, I learn a lesson, I learn a lesson, I learn a lesson.
If I fail, I learn a lesson, I learn a lesson, I learn a lesson.
I had a crash course in Somali. The most important word is himlo, because it means hope. Let me ask you the question: who is the most important role, or who has the most important role in the education of children?
Parents.
Yes, it's the parents. Because the parents nurture the child from the beginning. They help the child to take the first steps. They listen to the adventures in school. Take them along to community events. And so on, you know, go to workshop. So parents are the most important. But then the problem is, at some point, it breaks down, you know. The communication can break down. So where can Himmelo help? We are specialized in offering accredited training courses to the refugee and migrant community. We do this because we have the personal experience and know how hard it is to integrate ourselves in this British community.
If you go to creativeyouthnetwork.org.uk, you can have a look at everything that we do. First, we run a whole load of courses which are free to access in everything from photography to drama, a range of other art forms. So if young people are interested in taking part in that, they are open to everybody. Second of all, we run youth clubs, so open access, anybody can come youth clubs. But we do understand that some young people don't feel comfortable coming to a new place with a new community. So we run two particular programs, one at the station, which is called Welcome Wednesdays, which is for newly arrived young refugees and asylum seekers, which is very well attended. And we also run a very specific Somali youth program up in our Hillfields Youth Club, which is a little way, probably a mile or two up in that direction, which is for the Somali community. So we have parents, younger children and young people attending that. And the only thing I'll finish with is to talk about, well, how do we integrate more? Because we do struggle to reach out, particularly to the Somali community. We do have some young Somali people coming to what we do. But one of the key things is please apply for some of the jobs that we have on offer. We do, we probably have two or three jobs advertised at any one time. We are looking for Somali workers to help us to engage Somali young people. And equally invite us to things like this. We really appreciate it. And thank you. The report looks great and I'll read it with interest when it comes out soon. And I'm also, the final thing I'll say, we have been working with Abdullahi, the Barnhill Settlement. I've met with Osman earlier today and one or two others. I'm not allowed to tell you what it is, but we do have a little bit of funding that we'll be able to use to work in this area soon. We're not allowed to announce it officially, but we are going to be looking to work with you guys in the near future. So please keep an eye out for that. And you know, anybody who wants to get involved, please talk to the Somali Resource Centre. Thank you.
Thank you for having me here. My name is Rachel Beattie and I am a Commission Manager at Bristol City Council. And really, Councillor Asher Craig did my job for me earlier, because really all I was going to ask you today was to engage in the Targeted Youth Services consultation, which runs until the 27th of April, later on this month. So this is what it looks like. So we've written a commissioning plan, and this is for Bristol City Council funded youth and play services that will be changing from 2018, March 2018. So this is the part where we're gathering information, so the report is coming really at a timely moment. for us commissioners who are planning the services, and later on in the year we'll be asking providers to bid to run these services from next year. We're also working with the Black South West Network to run a consultation for BME-led organisations, and that's going to be held at City Hall on the 24th of April. So it's quite a small event, but there are a few places left, so it would be really good to have your input in it. There's an online consultation questionnaire, or you can email back your thoughts to us, and hopefully we can share the links for the consultation with the notes to this group. That would be really good. So, but do come and find me. We'll be here until the end if you've got any questions or comments. Thank you.
So for those of you who don't know me, my name is Archie Morrell. I work for Learning Partnership West. We are a support and learning organisation providing opportunities for children and young people from the ages of 8 up to 19 and up to 25 if they've got a learning difficulty or a disability. I'm going to keep it short and sweet. We deliver the Bristol Youth Links contract, which is the current kind of version of the targeted youth support service that Rachel just mentioned. And we provide a number of opportunities for children and young people to either engage in kind of positive activities or kind of targeted support, so one-to-one or targeted group work. I'm working with a number of people in this room already. If you'd like to come and work with us, then please do just get in touch.
My name's Lewis. We've been working with the Smiley Resource Centre for Dahi and Barton Hill Settlement for about 3 years now, running DigiLocal, which is a kids' club for them to learn about critical thinking, programming, Minecraft. It's not teaching them code, it's teaching them the critical skills that they will use, whatever career they have. It's going to involve technology. It's every Saturday from 3 till 5 here. We're here throughout the summer holidays, we're here throughout the school term, we're here at the Christmas break. I think we took a week off at Eid, a week off at Christmas, but otherwise we're here every week. We're really keen to get more kids coming in. We have had up to 30 kids. We've had up to 3 kids. We're always here every week, Saturday 3 till 5. Really keen to see more of you here. And if we need to run more clubs, the kit is there. It's there to be used. And if we can make it happen, I'm very keen to do that.
I live in Bristol. I'm here today as a member of the Bristol tech community. I've been living in Bristol now for close to 10 years. I guess I'm here today to sort of see, as an employer or a consultant, if we can do anything to offer any help starting some of the issues that have been raised in the report today. So I'm going to talk to you about 3 things. First, to tell you a little bit about the tech cluster and community in Bristol. And number 2 is to tell you a little bit about some of the barriers that we face as an IT company in widening participation. And number 3 is to tell you a little bit about some of the things that we can offer to help. So Bristol is the slide number 1, which is telling you about the tech community in Bristol. Bristol has one of the largest and fastest growing tech clusters in the UK outside of London. There are many companies around the Bristol central area, around Central Mead. So you have the likes of the company I work for, Oracle, it's also HP, and Amazon are also here, and many other fast growing, and there's a big startup community as well in Bristol. The universities in Bristol as well, such as UWBOT and the University of Bristol itself, have a lot of tech-related and IT-related courses, and they have a lot of engagements with the industry. So for number 2, so some of the challenges that we see is widening participation. And not only that, there's already a big skill shortage in the UK and around the world for IT. So what we're really interested in is removing any barriers that exist to make IT a viable career and an option for many of the youth or from a BME background.
I'm Amy Gallivan. I'm the engagement lead for Vabasa, and essentially what Vabasa does is for 16 to 25 year olds with their professional aspirations. What does that mean? We want to be that third space, so we're not home, we're not school, we're a third space where young people can come to realise professional aspirations, to realise may not have done well in school, or may not have someone that's gone to university, or may not have someone in a professional role, we want to kind of bridge that gap. I'll just say about the offers that we can, because today I really want to get that collaboration going, as echoed by the report and all of you guys being here. So the first way, we do constructive activities, echoed in the report, but also what we do is have professional mentors, we get a business community in to meet with young people, to talk about what it's like to be in that job, what you know, qualifications you may or may not need, so we do that. Also we do one-to-one support again, learning those practical skills. So, you know, what is a CV? How do you nail an interview? How do you write that cover letter and apply for work? And lastly, we have inspirational events. So we've got an event coming up at the end of the month. It's an intergenerational networking event. So we've got 100 professionals from a whole host of different careers and 100 young people come in to find out what jobs are out there, how do you apply for these jobs, for them to actually see I can be in one of those jobs. And that's at the end of the month, so I'll finish now, but I'll be here at the end and I've got some information. Yeah, we'd love to speak to you all.
My name is Khalil Abdi. I work with Bristol Home Youth Concern. I'm a youth worker. We do a lot of work with the young people, train the young people around drug, cannabis and alcohol and laughing gas. So this is an issue that is increasing in Eastern and Lower Sea, so we have been working with that. And we also train the young people around sex relationship, and we work in partnership public health. We also work in HANA from in Somali in Forum. And we deliver in local school, it's a primary school. We've done at the end of March in Medbank primary school. That was successfully, a lot of parents, around 35 parents attended. And also we do another schools that we do in the next few weeks. This has been increasing since we've done this work for the young people. A lot of parents come up now asking, can you do this? And also schools are engaging now. And also we work elderly, and we run some activities like swimming and healthy eating food. And also we work the other agencies, like this is very important that we work very closely with the Somali organization and other cultural organizations like public health, and also we work youth funding team, and we work and we visit to the prison. We organized Somali Resource Center with Abdullahi, and we went to the prison, meet the young people, and we work with that. We wanted to mentor for the young people. Also, we work for the youth funding team. It was very difficult to engage the young people for them, but one day, this is a positive thing. You can see they were difficult. There was a barrier, but when they worked with us, this has become successful. A lot of young people now we mentor, work with them, and that's the gap between the service provider. If they work in the community, the young people get in the service and they can reach with the, through the Somali organizations, and this is a positive thing. Now we mentor young people, provide opportunity for young people, improving social and emotional skills, and family education for the young, sometimes mediation for the family and the young person. So this is a success. When we're working together, there's a positive outcome. But the problem is sometimes it's very difficult the other agency to engage with the Somali community. And that's where the problem is. Now, this changed, and that's the example you can see that we are improving that.
We work with the whole family, not just with one specific person, but it's all combined, so we're all in touch with each other. I also work with local mosques. I bring children from out of Bristol into Bristol, to the local mosque and Sikh temple, to give them a better awareness of your cultures. I work with the schools. So if you're not sure about Think Manage, my name should be in most of the schools, and if not, I'll make sure it is. So there's a contact number and everything on there. If you've got any queries, you think your child's sort of truant in, or maybe going down the wrong path, then just give me a call, and I'll do my best to either help them myself or put them on the right people.